the sense that those who have installed solar under net billing agreements or net metering agreements are not necessarily paying their fair share for the infrastructure.
I'm not surprised that California might lose 22% or maybe has already lost 22% of their solar jobs. That's 17,000 jobs, Warren. That's a ton of jobs.
It's not all doom and gloom, but there is a trend here that we're seeing states moving or utilities trying to move away from receiving very little compensation from those who go solar. Welcome to In the Loop with Larry, our first edition of the year, January 2024. Happy New Year, everybody. We have some really interesting items for discussion today, particularly what's happening. It seems like the war against or the battle against net metering, both in Idaho and in California. So, Larry, this first article that came up is on Solar Power World, where I believe it was Kelly Pickerell who wrote this article, that Idaho ends net metering, shifts instead to a net billing system for solar compensation. And that on December 29th of last year, just a couple of weeks ago, the Idaho Public Utilities Commission approved this compensation change for people who own solar systems from net metering to net billing. And what does that mean for solar owners in Idaho?
Yeah, so Warren, as you know, I mean, as we've discussed before, net metering has been huge in the proliferation of solar installations in the US and really around the world. Yeah. What this does, Warren, and we've seen similar things in California. I think there's some talk in Arizona. So we're kind of seeing this shift. What it does is net metering allows you to say, okay, if I produce an extra kilowatt hour, I'm going to get that full value of that kilowatt hour as a credit from my utility. What the utility is saying now is, no, you're going to get a lower credit for what you overproduce and push back out than for what you actually buy from the utility. So if you look what you've highlighted there, Warren, you know, the Sierra Club estimates the new compensation rate will be 5.96 cents. So basically 6 cents rather than 8.8 cents. That means it used to be, whether I would use the kilowatt hour or send it out, I was getting the value of 8.8 cents for every kilowatt hour I was producing. Now, if I use it, I get 8.8 cents. If I send it out, I get 6 cents. So that's the difference that we're seeing here.
Right. And so what that does is it pushes the payback of solar out several more years and reduces the return on investment on the project.
Correct. Yep. Yep. Yeah. And you know, here it's kind of like, okay, well, 6 to 8.8 cents, that's not that big of a difference, but it's still a difference. I mean, it's still going to be significant, especially for customers that maybe are gone during the day when their system's producing a lot and they're not using that as much on site.
Sure. Sure. And it says here that the new rooftop solar rate structure took effect on January 1st. The net billing structure will use time adjusted rates calculated on an annual basis by Idaho Power. The expected change in rates should be close to Idaho Power's original proposal of an average annual export rate of 5.96. During the public utility hearings, not one person testified in favor of the proposal. Idaho Power proposed cutting solar rates based on an internally produced value of distribution energy resources study. And the Sierra Club and other environmental groups hired as independent analysts that concluded that Idaho Power was severely undervaluing rooftop solar value by using their own selective data.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And this is really where the battle is, Warren, because at the end of the day, as we install more and more solar in the grid, we have to come to grips with the reality that our customers should be compensated for the value of their energy, not necessarily the same value of the energy that they're buying. You know, depending when it's produced, depending where it's delivered to, that could affect the value of the energy. But I think the big battle, Warren, is what is the value of that energy? Nobody knows. I mean, it's changing every hour. It's constantly changing. You know, the Idaho's going to change it every year. How do you measure that? How do you figure that out? So the utility is going to make it as low as they possibly can. Organizations like the Sierra Club wants to make it as high as they possibly can. And somehow we have to figure out what that actually should be.
Right. And to The utilities credit, there's this sense that those who have installed solar under net billing agreements or net metering agreements are not necessarily paying their fair share for the infrastructure, the transformers, the lines, all of the equipment to get the energy to their home and be available when they need it in the evenings or when it's cloudy or whenever they choose to, for that small monthly customer fee of $5 or $10 a month. Mm-hmm. And that those costs are being subsidized by everybody else who's paying the full rate for electricity and doesn't have solar.
Yeah. So it's not an easy question or an easy solution. It's a very complex situation. And I don't think just because the utilities are making these changes that, like you said, Warren, I don't think it just means that they're bad, they're just being, you know, ridiculous. But I think that we do need to figure out how we value this over production at some point.
Yeah. So in addition to the Public Utility Commission in Idaho approving the change from net metering to net billing, they also approved a rate increase of the fixed monthly fees or the service charge. And it says that Idaho Power will double the fixed service charge on all residential customer bills from $5 a month to $10 a month in 2024. And then another jump from 15 in 2025, with future additional increases expected. And small commercial customers will see their fee increase from 5 to 25 this year. That's a substantial increase. And then, of course, continues to go on to say that studies show that fixed charges are harmful to low energy users and low income families.
Yeah, so that's a big jump. And I'll just start by saying $5 a month is so tiny. I mean, yeah, we're in the Northeast. I mean, we're typically seeing $15, $20, $25 a month for residential customers. So changing it to 15 by 2025, I don't think is crazy. But what I don't like here, Warren, is that when exactly what it says here, when you put up that fixed charge, you're penalizing people that are energy efficient, that are energy conscious, low-income families that are using less, and benefiting those that are using more. Now take that with a grain of salt, because at the end of the day, again, the utilities have to fairly charge customers what it costs to be connected. You know, the utilities paying for the meter, they're paying to keep your lines up, they're paying for your transformer, you know, they're charging you for electricity. So I get it. The utility has to figure out where that cost needs to be. But I think utilities need to be careful about unfairly or unreasonably putting this charge up and then hurting the people that are energy efficient, which in my mind is a big negative.
Yeah, it's a tough balance for the utilities for sure. And then the article goes finally on to say that a tax against solar or net metering in 2023 led to real harms in the industry. An unpopular net metering reform in California could lead to the loss of thousands of solar jobs. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. But there is some good news for those who already installed solar prior to 2024 in Idaho and have net metering agreements in place. And that this article on Solar Power World, Idaho PUC preserves net metering for existing solar customers. So the good news is, if you already had solar and a net metering agreement in Idaho prior to this change, that you are essentially grandfathered in.
Yeah. Yeah. When I see this, I always breathe a sigh of relief, because to me, this is key. Utilities have to respect existing customers. If utilities start making changes without respect for customers that already have agreements, we're in trouble. It's going to be really, really difficult to have customers be comfortable with the investment. So I like when I see this. I mean, California's done this. As far as I know, most of the states that have made major changes have done this. There might be a few independent utilities in the U.S. that have not done this, but by and large, for the most part, this is what we're seeing.
Yeah, it almost seems to be precedent at this point that existing customers are grandfathered in. And interestingly enough, as it says here, that the Public Utilities Commission issued a unanimous decision rejecting the proposal that would have ended the net metering program for existing customers. The commission decided that the evidence it had was insufficient to demonstrate that the proposed settlement was fair, reasonable, and in the public's interest, as well as finding that the public lacked adequate notice that significant changes to net metering would be made through the settlement.
Yeah, it's just, that's just common sense.
Yeah.
In my mind.
Yeah. And in addition, the commission ruled that Idaho powers 4,000 plus families and small businesses who either already have solar or who made binding commitments to install solar as of the date of today's order will continue to benefit from the net metering program's 1-to-1 kilowatt hour credit for electricity the customer sends to the grid, and future customers will be subject to the new program that results from the cost benefit study. I think there's an understanding that, Larry, from the PUC's perspective, and we've seen this across states, that people have made substantial investments based on net metering agreements, and to pull the rug would be unjust or unfair.
That's right. That's exactly right. The other thing that I like that I see here is that anyone that had a signed commitment prior to this date is able to get net metering. I mean, if I'm reading that correctly, it doesn't even mean that they have an approved interconnection agreement with the utility. I know California did something similar. So they gave customers time to respond before the change was made, which I think is very good for people that are considering it now, have been thinking about it for a long time. They can make that agreement hopefully in time and get the net metering.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's not all doom and gloom, but there is a trend here that we're seeing states moving or utilities trying to move away from receiving very little compensation from those who go solar, either by changing or somehow by changing their billing structure and shifting costs around. We're seeing that starting to take trend across the country. So if you're in an area that still offers net metering, now's your opportunity. Because as you see, you'll more than likely be grandfathered in if you're considering going solar and you still have net metering where you live. All right, Larry, let's jump to what's going on in California now. This article by Billy Lutt, Calissa, California, the Solar and Storage Association is mentioned that California is to lose 22% of solar jobs by the end of the year. And most of this is driven by the changes to net metering that happened in California recently. Just over 7 months ago, Governor Gavin Newsom appointed the California Public Commission's Utilities Commission that made drastic reductions to net energy metering. The program responsible for reducing the cost of going solar by compensating system owners for the energy production, by slashing the value of solar energy shared back to the grid by solar homes and businesses by 70 to 80% overnight.
Yeah, this is just the result of when you take net metering away or make a drastic change. I mean, I'm not surprised that California might lose 22% or maybe has already lost 22% of their solar jobs. That's 17,000 jobs, Warren. That's a ton of jobs. But when you make this significant of a change, that it's just what's going to happen. Like, you can't make a change like this overnight without a drastic reduction in demand and a drastic, you know, loss of jobs and probably a lot of companies going out of business.
Yeah, and this really flies in the face of California's green energy posture and renewable energy stance. Since the CPUC's decision, solar industry is experiencing business closures and depression level layoffs at a time of unprecedented federal support for solar. So not only is California known for really being a green state and pushing it, we have the IRA bill and a ton of federal support to push solar. It just doesn't seem like the timing, or it flies in the face of a lot of other initiatives going on.
It does. It certainly does, Warren. And to be fair, you know, California has a ton of solar and they have to come to grips with this. It had to come to this at some point. You just think, is there a better way to do this? Could you have done this in multiple steps? I don't know what that looks like, but at some point you have to get to this place. Is there a better way to do it? I mean, the industry was unbelievably hot for the first quarter of last year because everyone was trying to get their application in before this change. And now it's unbelievably cold. You know, so to jerk an industry around like that just is not, it's not good when you're hoping to develop a long-term industry.
Yeah. And then, of course, the article goes on to break down the estimated job losses per region. And you can see here some of the more hard hit regions, the Bay Area, the Central Valley, as well as Southern California hit pretty hard. The executive director of Calissa, Bernadette Del Chiario, said, "No one expected a supposed climate leader like California to be pulling the plug on green jobs and our fastest and most accessible path to a clean energy future. But that is where we are today. Under the CPUC's leadership, California is responsible for the largest loss of solar jobs in our nation's history."
Yeah, yeah. It's and the unfortunate thing here, Warren, is that we need to be putting solar on rooftops, small systems on rooftops. You know, we can put massive systems out in the desert, out in farmland somewhere, but the most effective land use is to put on rooftops. And that's, this is going to be a major challenge for a big industry like California.
Yeah. But I think, as you mentioned, Larry, the adoption of solar in California was so rapid for so many years, probably ahead of most states in this country, if not all of the states, that eventually this was coming.
Yeah, yeah. And one thing I'll just add to that. So I've seen various numbers on how they expect this to expand paybacks. I think they're saying, you know, 5 to 6 year paybacks going to like 10, 11, 12 year paybacks. But if you install storage, maybe you can pull that back to like 8 or 9 years. I'll just say this, in the Northeast, a lot of our customers have 10, 11, 12, 13, 15 year paybacks, and they're still installing solar. So I think eventually customers come back around and say, you know what, this is a 25, 30 year investment. I'm okay with a 12 year payback. I'm okay with a 10 year payback. I'm okay with an 8 year payback. It's going to take some time. I think they're going to get there, but it does eliminate a lot of customers that are kind of on the edge. Do I do this or don't I? 5 year payback, hey, no brainer. 10 year payback, that's a little bit more challenging for a lot of customers. So it'll be interesting to see what happens long-term. Long-term, I think the industry will come back as electric rates increase. It's just, you know, you're going to lose a lot of companies. You're going to lose a lot of trained people, a lot of skilled people, which is very unfortunate for the industry.
Yeah. And one last point I think we should just touch on here, Larry, is that as storage continues to evolve and come down in pricing, that'll really have an impact on these states that are moving away from net metering. And it'll make solar more advantageous, obviously, if instead of you getting that lower price per kilowatt that you're sending back to the grid, you can store it and use it at a later time. That'll benefit a lot of these customers where we're seeing the move to net metering as well.
Absolutely. And it benefits the grid. You know, it takes production from high production times, puts it into times when you have lower production. So it really helps everyone. So, I mean, I think there's two things. One is storage is going to become more of a thing. I mean, in California, they might see 60, 80, 100% of their residential systems include storage. And then the second thing is, if you've got net metering today, take advantage of it. Don't wait, because it's hard to know when this spreads across the country.
Absolutely. Well, thank you, Larry. Appreciate all your insight.